trailhead full of zombies. I met a strange lady, she made me nervous. She took me in and gave me breakfast. And she said, do you come from a land down under? A women go and men wonder. Can't you hear the thunder? You better run, you better take cover.
G'day, Brendan O'Connell. It's Thursday, the 23rd of February 2017. I'm walking along in downtown Kuala Lumpur, trying to make things a little bit more interesting rather than a windowless hotel room. I have to make some commentary about Netanyahu's visit to Australia. It's too good to pass up. Of course, I'm trying to focus on my case, getting material out about my case, and I keep getting distracted. Netanyahu, why is he in Australia? I'll tell you exactly why he's in Australia. Apart from the fact they're forming alliances with Great Britain, the United States and Australia, the big three, the sons and daughters of the British Empire, all of them set up by a form of British intelligence one way or the other. They lost the United States, they're trying to get it back. They've semi-lost Australia, and I'm actually not necessarily against the monarch at this moment in time. In fact, we need to go back to the Australian Constitution Act of 1901, and then if people want to become a republic, that's fine, they can vote on it. But right now we're in the hands of the Talmudic Acts and Statutes, you know what I'm talking about. It was a takeover by the Fabian Socialists, people like the Rhodes Scholar Bob Hawke, the little arch Zionist lunatic Bob Hawke, who has in Israel forests named after him. He and Paul Keating did the coup de grace to the Australian Constitution in the 1986 Australia Act, which fundamentally wiped out the Australian Constitution in a very... I mean, you can't do it, but they did it anyway. You've seen me at the front of the Perth District Court ranting on about this. We have pyramids, great big pyramids on the front of our Perth District Court to all the big legal eagles out there, the amateur bush lawyers. Why aren't you writing to the Attorney General and asking why the State Coat of Arms or the Royal Seal is not on the front of the Perth District Court? It's a privately owned building, it's owned by guess who. So usually they hide their little pyramids somewhere, but not anymore. They just put them directly on the front of the building so you know who's the boss. And of course, the master mason of Perth was Inspector Steve Jancic, who lost his job after I went out public on him in August of 2014. The Sutri family of Perth and the rapes that went on, many of you know who Mary is. Mary, of course, has been a campaigner exposing pedophile rings, all sorts of sexual depravity. Her daughter was raped by the... I met Mary and saw her incredible archive of material, where it goes all the way back to 1988, 1986, whereby royal commissions into child sexual abuse said there are literally satanic pedophile rings operating in Perth. Unfortunately, Mary claimed, after she contacted me, knowing who I am, that she couldn't work with me because I hate the Jews. What a shame, Mary. I don't hate the Jews, but I can't be bothered trying to convince you. She's an evangelical Christian, and she's held deep in the heart of the... Christian Zionist movement. So we can kiss her goodbye, shame, because that archive she's got is probably going to get firebombed one day. It's that good. So with this in mind, what I need to do is try and convince you how important Western Australia is at the moment. What we need to understand also is that Alan Gingell, the former head of the Office of National Assessments, it was rumoured and told to me that he lost his job over me because some bum off the streets managed to write a dossier called my High Court Synopsis in jail with a broken arm that basically embarrassed the living crap out of the Australian intelligence community because they didn't see it. It was to do with the Collins class sub, compromised weapons and sensor systems, the close relationship between China and India of Israel, and how Israel is basically arming all the sides up. You know what I write about in terms of Israel and high technology contracts. Variant do the Sydney Rail Transit System. Israel is doing all the Class A infrastructure security. They did Fukushima. You know they did Fukushima. They've recently got contracts to do the in India, the Indian ports, do the security for the ports. Have you seen the picture of the Indian army officer just looking sourly? He knows. They're being forced to do this. Money. Because Israel's got all the leadership. They're all pedophile, whack job, sexual deviants. And Israel's got them all on the books. Because Israel literally controls the telecommunications industry. They do all the billing. I have to say it again and again. Amdocs, PTEC, Variant, Converse, InfoSynth, Rad Group, Zohar Zisapel, Operation Talpiot, Israeli military intelligence, and on and on and on. I've done videos on this time and again. Go and look them up. And I've been raided multiple times over this. I've been hounded and harassed and death threats. galore, rung by ministers, invited out for coffees with the heads of counterterrorism, Inspector Barry Shelton. The Israeli state came out against me in August of 2010. Again, I have to repeat it for those of you who don't know. The Israeli ambassador, Yuval Rotem, came out against me. The Israeli deputy foreign minister, Danny Ayalon, came out against me. Our own foreign minister, Stephen Smith, came out against me, and 135 local and federal members of parliament expressed written support for the August the 8th Friends of Israel rally in Western Australia, organised by Jewish community leader and case officer Stephen Leiblich, who, when I called him a katzer, had my house raided for offending him via a carriage device, which the charges later dropped. Have a look.
What is it, Liz? Terrorism? Is there a big terrorism thing now? What? Who have I offended, Liz? Has Stephen Leiblich had his feelings hurt? Are you embarrassed, Liz? Seriously, are you embarrassed? Did they force you into jail? Oh, fuck, please, no, I don't want to do it. I just want to bring this on his property.
I do have
to. Do you, please, to any of you WA police, are you capable of talking the truth ever? Ever?
So I'm hoping, slowly but surely, I'm getting through to people the level my case is operating at, because I can't get an interview. I recently had an interview with Herewood Fenton of Truth News Radio Australia. Here's the link.
He joins us from Kuala Lumpur, and his name is Brendan O'Connell, an Australian, a man who really has done some very interesting work looking into issues about Israeli influence in Australia, Israeli control of corporations, particularly in the security industry, and has challenged some of the more extreme laws in relation to anti-discrimination, and has actually really gone to great lengths in trying to hold up the principle of freedom.
That actually went really well. Herewood does an excellent job. He's very professional. There's no Yetis on his show. There's no big-breasted blondes. There's no UFOs. There's no shape-shifting lizards. And he won't slag off Muslims. So as Herewood said, he won't get the big audience, which is true. So why is Benjamin Netanyahu? Why is he in Australia? I'm telling you right now, in part, it's my case. Clearly, the Australian Federal Police database was dropped. That was formerly PROMIS, P-R-O-M-I-S. You must look up the history of PROMIS. That is a documentary in itself. PROMIS was Israeli software that linked highly disparate databases, and it formed all over the world. It formed police databases everywhere. Do you realize the power that gives the Israeli state? Well, they had a new piece of software, and they lobbied $145 million for this software database. And after I screamed and yelled about it and was invited out for coffees with the head of local counterterrorism, Inspector Barry Shelton, in 2010, just before the Israeli ambassador turned up, the Australian Federal Police and government departments finally dropped the Israeli software. And I'm telling you now, no ifs, no buts, that was because of me. That's the level I'm operating at. I am making changes by my screaming. I'm going to scream a little better. I'm not going to rant as much, but you've got to start taking notice of my case. You've got to stop dropping the shape-shifting lizard crowd, the freaking UFO crowd, the Alex Jones crowd, the globalist crowd, and all the nice words, and start talking about Israel and Orthodox Judaism and Jewish racial and religious supremacism as the foundation of the Israeli state. And if we start moving as one to some degree in a clenched fist, as the famous General Heinz Guderian, the father, literally the father of modern armoured blitzkrieg coordinated attack warfare, says, you don't hit someone with open fingers, you make a fist. And we're not doing it. We're all off on 50,000 different tangents. We're all bumping into each other. We're arguing with each other. Everybody's making a mess of it, including me. I've had to be bitch slapped to wake up. And I'm urging people, for God's sake, use my case as the precedent. There's nothing higher. I was verbally given political asylum in Iran, and there's the proof that they were extending my visa for 3 months. I left because of that crazy wacko closet homosexual weirdo lawyer. I'm sure. Regardless, please bring back Mahmoud Ahmadinejad. I didn't care if he's got Jewish roots. That guy was smart as a tack, and he knew how to play the game, and he wasn't afraid to upset Israel. Same as Dr. Mahathir Mohamad here in Malaysia. How many of you even know how much Netanyahu hates Dr. Mahathir Mohamad? When in 2012 they had a 9/11 conference, that's probably why they lost those two aircraft.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Excellencies, members of the panel, of presenters, guests, ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And a very good morning to everyone.
I've made contact with the Malaysian consulate numerous times. They've got all my paperwork. Come on, people, we've got to start laying the boots in. So what is Benjamin Netanyahu doing? in Australia. Number one, he's not popular and he's disliked. Malcolm Turnbull doesn't like him. Malcolm Turnbull, of course, the former head of Goldman Sachs in Australia. Now, Malcolm Turnbull's a complicated character. I actually know people who've met him several times. They say he's actually a pretty sincere, nice guy. Is he compromised? Maybe. I don't know. Is he Jewish? Don't know. Don't care. I want to know him by his fruits. Being a former head of Goldman Sachs tells me we've already got trouble. What most of you don't know, he was also the personal lawyer for Kerry Packer, one of the most violent, lunatic nutcase, though a proud Australian. I'll give him that. He was a proud Australian. Kerry Packer, of course, Goanna was his code name by the Australian Crime Commission. The man who was involved in murder, gold bullion theft, fraud, standover tactics, you name it. He was virtually an ASIO agent. Kerry Packer, of course, was compromised by Abraham Saffron, the Jewish mafia don of Australia. How many of you know this? Sir Frank Packer, Kerry Packer's father, was highly compromised in a pedophile ring involving Abe Saffron. Abe Saffron, of course, specialised in blackmail. Before there was Jeffrey Epstein, there was Abe Saffron. Apparently, I actually know people who knew him in jail, would you believe, many years ago. They said he was an extremely likable fellow. I'm sure he was. He was also an agent for the State of Israel, like Jeffrey Epstein, and his job was to compromise politicians and leaders of industry. And he did that meticulously. He owned the entire New South Wales establishment, including the Premier, the Police Commissioner, everybody. Finally, they knocked him down. He went a bit quiet. They got him on tax evasion. But that guy was the original Jeffrey Epstein. Watch this extract now where his son tells you that they had people compromised at the highest levels. And every time you put this up, they will take this documentary down, but I will get it up there for people on Google Drive. Watch now.
Historical sense, Abe Saffron would have to be classified as Australia's most vile, amoral, and absolutely corrupt criminal.
He was a small Jewish boy from the wrong side of the tracks in Sydney's inner west. He grew up to be one of the most mysterious and slightly notorious of all Sydney colourful characters.
He was named by three Royal Commissions as being the number one organised criminal in Australia.
We went to Israel quite a bit because Abe had friends there and he loved being in Israel.
But they wasn't entirely free as it appeared, because Saffron also had the rooms that they used tapped with listening devices and also cameras. They would take pictures of what was occurring and then present them to the victim, and they were theirs from then on.
He would have over a minister, a police commissioner, businessmen, very, very high-ranking people, people of the most highest ranks.
How do you like that? Do you understand how it works? Before Jeffrey Epstein, there was Abraham Saffron, and Kerry Packer, okay, was totally compromised. He was a sexual deviant. Many said he inspired loyalty in his employees. He was proudly Australian. Apparently, he despised Rupert Murdoch. I actually know someone who personally knows Packer. And he said, yeah, look, everything says true, but he was highly compromised. He wasn't inherently bad, but he was toast under Saffron, as was his father. And, of course, Packer himself became an expert at bribery and blackmail himself. And, of course, there's Malcolm Turnbull, our now Prime Minister, the top lawyer for Kerry Packer. So you can start joining some dots, Goldman Sachs and all the rest. So what is Netanyahu doing here? You've got to understand that axis of evil, which is now Great Britain, the United States, Israel, and the fourth, the feminine, the completion of that little axis of evil, Australia. Australia is sitting under the greatest economic expansion in history, under 3.5 billion people in China and India. There is massive economic development going because they are replacing the United States with India and China. Israel has all its hardware, software, and security surveillance devices embedded into the Chinese and Indian infrastructure. They have total control over the Chinese and Indian infrastructure. If China so much as step out of line, that will be the end. And we'll see little things like when China stepped out of line in 2012 and their stock market dropped 13% overnight. The next day they learnt their lesson like a good little boy, and their stock market went up again by 13%, and they learnt their little lesson. Currently they've done deals with various groups, particularly the European banking crowd, the Jewish European, more cultured banking crowd out of Europe. they're playing one off against another. They're doing deals with Iran. Iran's doing deals with China. Basically, deals are being vaporized, smashed, reforged, smashed again, reforged. It's everywhere at the moment. Even my beloved favorite politician of all time, Dr. Mahathir Mohamad, the man who kicked George Soros in the butt in 1997. Even he has apparently, so the word goes, made up a little bit with George Soros. So it appears that there are deals being done everywhere, at all levels, at all times. Nothing, everything is up for grabs. Nothing is sure. It's a crazy time politically. I can't work it out. If you can, good luck. So that's why Netanyahu is busy down here in Australia, shoring up, putting in all their infrastructure. They're doing communications, VoIP encryption for government, all these people using Wicca. Now, Wicca's great bit of security device for private encrypted comms. At a low level if you want to keep the state police out, but I assure you Wicca is a CIA/NSA front based in Kentucky. They have one server in Kentucky, and if you are working at any significant level in business or in government, they have your data, period. A far better option is, of course, GNU PGP encryption via email. There are ways to be very, very secure, but it takes time and effort. You've got to understand that Israel has got to shore up. Have you seen the look on Malcolm Turnbull's face? He doesn't like Netanyahu. He's not happy. They do as they're told, or maybe an airliner will disappear into the ether. That was a warning to the middle management of the planet. Get too cocky. Try to kick Israel out. This is what's going to happen to you. Listen, does it not seem strange to you that this garbage can continue? Israel is on the record countless times, their rabbis, their politicians, calling for the slaughter of Palestinians, calling for the genocide of Palestinians and all Arabs. We've got Martin von Creveld, the European Jew from, I think it's the Netherlands, a military analyst saying that Israel has nuclear weapons aimed at Europe and they will use them if Israel is abandoned. Hello? Hello? Terrorist state? We have Yisrael Hassoun, a Syrian Jew, former head of the Shin Bet, stating to European ambassadors that if they abandon Israel, they will have jihadis in their kindergartens, in their beds, in their schools, in their shopping centres. It was a direct threat. Me and Louis did a report on that. Watch. How many? It doesn't even get, 3,000 views? My God, we're the only people talking about this. The entire mass migration you're seeing today was organised by Israel. Israel, Israeli intelligence, NATO. That's who ran that, not the US. It was run by Israel and Saudi Arabia and NATO. No one talks about it. Oh, it's Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton's a fucking call girl. Barack Obama, you know? Do we want to call him what he was? Well, you know what Louis Farrakhan called him. He's damn right. Wake up. Everyone is terrified of Israel because Israel controls the communications. They've got them all on record. The whole planet is run by a vast criminal pedophile man. Literally. You know, I always thought it was incidental to the conspiracy that they were using the weaknesses of people and exploiting weaknesses. No, this is a military intelligence operation to corrupt and compromise whole segments of the business, managerial, intellectual class, political class. This is a military intelligence operation. They are producing multi-generation trauma, mind-controlled. It's in MKUltra. It is on the freaking record. This is not fantasy land. It is in government documents. The Church Committee, all those Senate hearing committees on what was going on in the psychiatric institutions and in military intelligence fields. Wake up. Read Dave McGowan and his books on mind control. And these mass murderers we see. And now they're all closet homosexuals or sexual deviants. I mean, Kay Griggs has said it, and Kay Griggs talks. The entire government. Listen to what she says.
Your name is Catherine Pollard Griggs?
Yes.
You are the wife of Colonel George Griggs?
Yes.
11 years of marriage?
Yes.
It's true that your husband is and has been the head of special operations under Admiral Kelso, NATO?
Yes.
Also that your husband's background includes NATO Defense College in Rome.
Yes.
Princeton class of 1959.
Yes.
His intelligence career, his spy career began in Vietnam.
Yes.
And it's also true that it continues under this day.
Absolutely, under General Wilhelm.
And in fact, your husband was an alcoholic.
Absolutely.
And probably
Incredible.
Is to this day.
Absolutely.
And during these drunken stupors, he would, so to speak, blab on and tell you everything he knew about the
everything.
Intelligence community.
Everything.
Nothing was hid.
No.
It was like he wanted to relieve himself and unburden his heart.
Yes.
And so he told you everything that you now know about yes. the intelligence community.
Yes.
And also, by your association with him, you have come to understand and know as shocking as this may sound to the people who are viewing this, that the United States military is literally run by sexual deviants heavy on the homosexual side.
Truly.
And that the United States military, people like Jeffrey Dahmer and Kaczynski and McVeigh and Oswald and a host of other people who have a sexual deviant background, primarily homosexual, these individuals are actually sought out by people within the military,
the Army,
for advancement into intelligence type work because they are so easy to control.
Yes.
And they actually become mind slaves, and that the U.S. military, literally, as outrageous as it sounds, is a mind control operation.
Yes, totally now. Totally now. They've gotten rid of the good folks, like MacArthur. Got rid of them, one by one.
Good.
Totally take over.
Well, she lays it out in a 7-hour interview that the entire planet is run by a clique of lunatic, criminal, pedophile, closet homosexual, and bisexual virtual cult. And it is being produced at the scientific industrial scale level under military intelligence operations. And beyond that, at the deeper spiritual occult levels, and Henry McCow recently did an article on this, it is worse than that. It's sheer evil. And they are operating on a spiritual level. Quantum physics shows us we're all just vibration. They are doing things which are invoking energies and powers you can't quite understand or comprehend. Mind you, you'll happily admit to parallel universes and wormholes and time travel. What do you think they're doing in that ruddy great particle accelerator in Switzerland? They're doing all sorts of crazy stuff. But when you mention vibration, energy, I mean, you're a receiver and a transmitter. That's why prayer works. That's why you can manifest things. And if you do things and align yourself with that dark energy, you have no idea. You have no idea what you're dealing with. It's taken me years to wake up. It's taken me years. It's like a level, and you think, holy hell. These people are insane. They're not insane. They are sociopathic, borderline psychotic, massive use of drugs, methamphetamine, cocaine, high doses of Zoloft and other SSRIs. All right, they've totally lost any frontal lobe capacity for higher ethical thinking. They just know how to be evil, and it's hard for ordinary, decent people to comprehend what you're up against. It is, again, a scientific, mass-produced, like a Henry T. Ford production line. They are producing multi-generation trauma victims, and they're putting them in power. They're compromising them. It's bad. This is why, you know, I hang by my fingertips on Donald Trump. I got my fingertips into the concrete, barely hanging on that he's for real. When clearly Trump himself has got to be compromised. He was numerous times at Jeffrey Epstein parties. The allegations by the lady who's now in her late 20s when she was 13 are prima facie. I've watched all the stuff, I've read all the statements. They are credible that he was compromised at a Jeffrey Epstein party.
Second time that I saw Mr. Trump was same scenario. He was onlooking at an orgy, and Tiffany came over to me and said that Donald Trump had requested that I perform oral sex on him.
What else can explain his sycophantic attitude to Israel? That talk when he was, oh, I'm grabbing pussy, and remember he was recorded? He's off his head on cocaine. That's what they do. Drugs are very central to the compromising position. They throw a shard of methamphetamine or cocaine. They get him very horny. They bring in the young boys, the young girls, the secretaries, whatever you're into. And boom, they've got you on camera. Just like Abe Saffron used to do for a living. It's so easy. Look at our former Prime Minister Kevin Rudd, who's coming for some shtick from Benjamin Netanyahu himself. Now, Kevin Rudd, I didn't like his politics, but as a person, I think he was semi-decent, very articulate. His stuff on education was excellent, if you ever read his stuff. Old glass jaw Rudd, he didn't like being criticised, though. He's obviously been groomed. He was taken by the New York Post, the head of the New York Post, into a strip club. How many of you even remember this? He was tossed out for groping the strippers. Is that the sort of behaviour you'd expect from Kevin Rudd? But if you put a shard of meth in his scotch, before you know it, ooh, you are horny as hell and ready to party. And they had him.
It's a gentleman's club, which may one day boast to having had Australia's Prime Minister through its doors.
I think any bloke, reflecting back on their own lives, realised there are a few times where they've just got it wrong.
4 years ago, Kevin Rudd was on an official visit to New York as Shadow Foreign Affairs Minister, when a dinner with Labor colleague Warren Snowden and the editor of the New York Post, Col Allen, saw the trio end up at a strip club.
We went on to a bar, which in fact turned out to be a club, And the rest is history. But the error that I made was going in there in the first place.
Mr. Rudd says he was too drunk to remember what happened, including reportedly being warned by bouncers at the club.
I have absolutely no recollection of any inappropriate behaviour.
He does remember telling wife Therese the next day and being forgiven. Embarrassed, Kevin Rudd says he now expects to take a beating in the opinion polls, the next of which is due out early this week. But on the question of whether his chances of becoming the next PM have been hurt, one Premier says, no way.
I think most Australians will say big deal and move on. It shows that he's human, shows that he's got blood in his veins.
And he just may be right.
Just another normal run-of-the-mill bloke.
What happened years ago, it's got nothing to do with politics at all.
Perhaps the Treasurer agrees, refusing to comment, except to say he's never been to Scores.
I find when I'm in America on official business that they pack your program pretty full.
Next time we know what Kevin Rudd will be doing.
Going straight back to the hotel.
Brad Hodson, 10 News.
And you know what happened not long after that? Remember when the assassination... that Palestinian resistance fighter in Dubai, and they used Australian passports. Well, who was the only prime minister, in fact, the only world leader anywhere to give it to Israel? Well, it was Kevin Rudd, to his credit. The Australian Federal Police went over to Tel Aviv and they made complaints. Big time. Who else does that? Nobody does that. But Australians did it. Aussie, 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 oi, 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 Anzac spirit and all that stuff. At least we did something. But they've got all the politicians and key players in banking and finance under control, and they are paying off people left and right, they are compromising people left and right, and the key is their high technology sector, Operation Talpiot, putting all their military intelligence people in private and government high technology industries, shipping all the contracts now to Israel where it's become Silicon Wadi. I had a chat with Harewood Fenton in his Truth News radio show, and he talked about, as a programmer, PHP, which is the largest free to use way of writing your web pages. It's used by everyone. It's free and it's the best. And guess who runs it? Is it Zen from Israel? Have a listen. Man, think of the stuff you can put in there, the features that'll give you backdoor access to all sorts of things. And it's at the server level. So man, they can do all sorts of stuff. This is what you must start getting interested in. I wish I could put some blondes with big boobies to try and get your attention. I don't know how to do it. I don't know how to get your attention, how important this is. If you continue to be led astray, I'll give you an example. David Icke. Now, I've got to say, good luck to David Icke. I'd rather he's there than not. He's brought a lot of people into this. He's explained a lot of things to people. But the shape-shifting lizard shit really pees me off. Does he believe in it? I have no idea. But he's very, very politically and advertising and marketing astute. But we've got to get it out of that crap level and start lobbying ourselves to our government departments and stop sitting on Facebook. I sent out a mass email. This form, as you know, one of my biggest, most watched postings is Israel, the greatest spy machine ever. It's one of my biggest. It's got nearly 700 likes on Facebook, got 30,000 views. That was the basis of a mass email. Because I was on bail conditions and couldn't post publicly, I was sending out mass emails using mail merge up to 700 to 800 politicians in both New Zealand and Australia. I sent out this email that you see here, talking about, I got six personal replies just saying, "Dear Mr. O'Connell, thank you for our email to our office. This is just a note to let you know we have read." And look at this one from Minister Chris Finlayson, in charge of New Zealand Intelligence, the Attorney General of New Zealand. This is the reply I got. Now, while you were on Facebook, I was lobbying, using mail merge, politicians, and they listened. When are you going to work out that, as Matt Drudge says, the internet has become a ghetto? You are sitting on corporate Twitter, corporate Facebook, corporate YouTube. You are getting sucked in and you're getting nothing back. You are being ghettoized. You are being condensed and put into a little control, like a kindergarten where you put all the kiddies into the sealed off playground and then they let you play. And if you get too naughty, they ban you and all that stuff and put you in the naughty room. Work it out. You have got to start writing letters to your members of parliament. You've got to start ringing them up and say, "There is a national security issue I wish to discuss with you. Are you aware of this? I suggest you download my legal material, in particular my High Court synopsis." Here it is. Isolate but preserve legal material. That's all you have to put into the search engine and you will get my legal material. It's only a 2.3 megabyte PDF from my High Court synopsis, done in jail in Albany Regional Maximum Security Prison with a badly broken arm. I was typing with one finger for 2 weeks. That was amazing. I did that. That is unaltered. I've not altered. I did that in jail. It was incredible. I was constantly in the theatre with, "When are you finished? What are you doing?" It took me 4 or 5 months. you know, work for 2 hours, stop, then get back. No, you can't go back to education. Every trick in the book to mess me around. But a lot of the prison officers were ex-army, and they came and shook my hand when they realised, hey, you're not a nut, man. That's amazing. They were reading that stuff. That was taken off me by Superintendent Wallace at Bunbury Minimum Prison. He said it's a security risk. Superintendent Wallace had undergraduate studies in counterterrorism. I gave him that synopsis. He was freaked out. He said, man, you've just got to get to the High Court. So I have a lot of support people. Help me get to the High Court. Keep funding me. Keep making donations. I've got nearly $800 in donations. Thank God. I can't tell you what a relief that is. That's going to last me at least 6 weeks. I still think going back to Australia is a good idea, but we'll wait and see. Wait and see. See if the donations keep up. I'm networking more. I'm getting more and more people coming on board. I'm trying to form a crew so I can do some damage. Otherwise, I've just got to head back to Australia and face the music. I've got to die in jail, do something crazy, hunger strike, smear my own fecal waste all over the walls like Bobby Sands did, and become the most horrible prisoner known to man. And trust me, it terrifies them when they get a prisoner like that, someone they can't control, they can't buy off, and that's me. I've already been through it once, trust me. Got to support me, please. Benjamin Netanyahu, you have got to start writing letters, and better than emails is writing physical letters. Will you please stop saying it's pointless? You morons! I know people who work in members of parliament offices, and they meticulously note every single bit of correspondence, whether it be email, fax or letter or phone call that comes in, because they are always doing social networking science to garner the mood of the community. You've got to write a good letter, very short, very concise, and you would say, dear Mr. Smith, and then put in, this is clearly a major national security issue. Here is the link to his legal paperwork and his High Court synopsis and his sentencing submissions for when they went after him again and terrorised him again. And Simon Freitag said he could not hand in those sentencing submissions. They were too controversial. Read it. You want to know what's going on. You can even mention to him that Mr. O'Connell states and his proven phone call, and I'll show you the email from the Department of Public Prosecution Senior Prosecutor David Thiering to my lawyer, Simon Freitag, stating that yes, the phone call to Minister Joe Francis did take place on October the 10th, 2014, where he said he was more scared of his own prison officers than he was of the bikies. This is a serving minister in charge of WA prisons. How we were going to have a beer, that I had nothing to fear because James McMahon, his head, James McMahon, the Commissioner of Corrective Services, ex-Special Forces Commander, had his back and I would be welcomed, we'd have a beer together. That is not in dispute, that call. They can dispute the contents, but that call took place. What do you think we talked about for 32 minutes? The weather? Are you beginning to grasp how big my freaking case is? It's huge. What do you think I'm on the freaking run for? Man, I fear for my life in Western Australia. Not all the police. I had a lot of good coppers came out and supported me, thank God, and military people, serving and retired. But WA is a strange place. It's full of South African intelligence, retired South African special forces, and you know the close relationship between Israel and South Africa. It is really close. It's full of South African Jews. It's full of retired British MI6, MI5, British ex-special forces. SAS Campbell Barracks is in WA. Not all bad people. There's some good family men in there. I knew plenty of them in the past. Got to understand my case. So write those letters. I'd say this is a national security issue. What are you doing about it? What is Benjamin Netan freaking Yahoo doing in Australia? What's he doing? He's shoring up support and he's visiting everyone going, you better be on our side and you better stop criticising us and you better stop exposing our lunatic Orthodox Jews. Right? As Israel Shamir said, The ultimate goal of the Jews is not Palestine or Greater Israel. It's the entire world. That's from Yisrael Shamir. Yisrael Shamir is one of the biggest Israeli activists in the world. He gets standing ovations at London universities. Paul Eisen, read British Jewish activist Paul Eisen. Read his stuff, Jewish Power, on righteousjews.org. Google Paul Eisen, E-I-S-E-N, and Jewish Power. Read that 10-page article. It's fantastic. This is what we're up against. We're up against an incredible organized criminal group. Remember, this is not even spiritual in some aspects. It's just a criminal investigation. I had some good responses from police. Unfortunately, we went to war. Unfortunately. And I still have some, my family's been threatened. My niece has been stalked by a man masturbating in a car. I could talk for hours about what's going on. That's why I'm a nervous wreck. And it's not so much because I'm afraid that I can't fight. I've got no resources. I didn't even have a place to live. And I was worried I was going to turn around and clock someone. Trust me, man. Physically, I'll take anyone on. I'd have guns pointed at me. That's just me. I'm not afraid. Seriously. When it comes to matters of principle, I'm not afraid. I'll take you on. I'm not saying I never get afraid, but I'm just telling you, I'll take it on. But it's turning around and hitting someone in the head and they fall down and they crack their skull. I'm in jail for freaking 10 years. That's what's making me anxious. And I don't have that power to just jump on a plane and get away and just have a break from the state. I never had that power. I did once. That's another story. I got a large donation from someone from the Middle East and it resulted in a police raid. That's another story. I made a lot of miscalculations. I, as people have said to me, Brendan, do you even realize what you're in, man? You have got to snap out of your naivety. I think I'm still naive. I think that's how I cope. So I'm asking you to understand the case, push my links everywhere, donate wherever you can. I need, give me 10 grand, give me 20 grand. I don't drink, I don't smoke, I don't go out, I don't party, I don't do anything but sit in front of that computer. The thing I bought recently is a $300 second phone. Because I need a second phone. My other one was acting up very strangely. It was getting really hot all the time. Man, you've got to look up. Go into YouTube and Google Israel High Technology Military. Have a look at what they're doing now. They have got stuff you would not believe. All stolen out of DARPA. All stolen out of DARPA, all right? They are stealing it. Dov Zakheim. Where do you think 2.3 trillion? I think it was closer to 3 trillion missing from the Pentagon budget. Where do you think that went? Rabbi Dov Zakheim, the comptroller for the Pentagon. Where did it go? We know where it went. Man, this thing, it goes so deep. Benjamin Netanyahu must not walk around Australia with impunity. You've got to tell your local elected members of parliament. You're the boss. They're your employees. This guy is a racist piece of garbage. And I mean racist in the truest sense. Not just small-time bigotry. Hey, you white dog. Yeah, you black bastard. I'm not talking about that small-time bigotry. I'm talking about a deep racial hatred where he thinks of himself as an exclusive, genetically endowed race. They do. They're nutcases. He's a freaking Pole, Slav, blonde hair, blue eyes. Netanyahu's not even his real name. He's from freaking Poland. He's got no connection to that state. He's not an Arab. He's not a Semite. He's a freaking raven, lunatic, racist piece of garbage. So I repeat, you must contact your members of parliament. They note every single, and I mean every single piece of paperwork that comes into that office, whether it be letter, email, phone or fax. You need to make appointments to visit your member of parliament. You need to download my High Court synopsis and understand the issue. You've got to get your fat backside off Facebook for at least 30%, 70% of the time maybe. Don't understand. It's a useful tool when used in the correct proportion. You have got to start working locally with your members of parliament. And you've got to get your member of parliament on the record. And that's where we've got to start lobbying. Stop pretending while you sit on that piece of garbage shit Zuckerberg machine Facebook that you're changing the world with your likes. You must go and attend to the political process. None of you are doing it. Very few. I don't even know anyone that's doing it on a grassroots level. I'd like to hear from you. Start lobbying, going into their offices, pressuring them, recording phone calls like I do, which they charge me with making a private telephone call public. This is so big and I can't get 10 decent people. Hopefully that's changing. I've had some good interactions with people and hopefully we can really start to do some damage. Ultimately, I must get to the High Court. I must return to Australia. We'll see what happens. We'll see what happens. I may head interstate first, see what happens, whether I'm extradited under normal circumstances, probably not. But because of the high profile nature of the case, they probably will extradite me. I'm not afraid. I'll go to jail. I'll spread my own fecal matter over the... I will be pissed on the floor. I don't care. I have no shame now. I'll sink to whatever level is necessary to win. I'll become the most unmanageable prisoner in the whole freaking country. They've sent me to Greylands numerous times. I always pass with flying colours. Dr. Shanu, a man from Romania with his thumbs cut off. He's retired now. Very nice psychiatrist. Said, Brendan, I understand. I've read your blog. I've seen what's going on. Just relax. I'm the only guy who ever been put in Greylands with 3 months to go on his sentence. And they said, look, you're fine. You're sane. Why don't you just relax here for the next 3 months of your sentence? It doesn't happen. They did it for me. I said, no, I have to go back. I've got obligations to prisoners to help them with their cases. All right, so Greylands is no problem. There's also my kind of people in Greylands. There's my kind of people too. It's got a lot of people who agree with me. I met them when I was there last time. So the psychiatrically, they're not going to do it. They'll have to stick me in one in Sydney and try it out. But I'll just spread the word. I'm like a virus. They keep putting me in places and I keep spreading the word. If they put me in jail, I'll go to protection and I'll meet all the pedophiles, and all the pedophiles give me the lowdown on all the judges and the police and whatnot. So that'll be good. They're not game to kill me. They'd lie to, but they're just not quite game to do it. I've got enough supporters out there. Enough decent coppers, decent intelligence, decent military people. But it's up to you. I've got to get a grassroots group going. Remember, that legal material is vital. There's the link. Go and read it. Look, it's pointless you're contacting me until you've read that, so you understand what you're talking about and what you're up against, or what I'm up against. And when you do, you'll go, oh. When Hamid Fadaroli, the senior international correspondent for Press TV, read the synopsis, he was blown away. And he ran Press TV, did everything they could to stop him making that documentary. So that's why I left on round two, and Hamid didn't have some nice words to say about his own company. Oh, I haven't told the full story, I just told someone over the phone. Do you think I would leave Iran on a whim? They were giving me everything I wanted. Just don't talk about Israel and spying and Jewish racial and religious supremacism. Just don't talk about that. Why am I even here? I had to fight tooth and nail to get that conference. I had to fight for 3 weeks by that whack job, closet homosexual, whatever he is. Lawyer. Oh, what a jeez. It was surreal. I got a book. The name of the book, by the way, is going to be Iran or Bust, : The Wild and Wacky World of the Internet Activist. Because I always said, Iran or Bust. I went to Iran and it busted. And I'm not saying all of Iran is like that. They're not. I met some great people there too. It's a complex thing going on there. They're doing deals. I don't know. They're surviving. I don't know. But anyway, what we're going to do is I'm going to close it off now. Benjamin Netanyahu should not be able to walk around the streets of Australia. Should be getting rotten eggs and goat's blood or God, whatever you can, get onto the piece of garbage. That man with that Likud party, neocon, Jewish and Christian Zionist nut job man, the Yanon plan. Watch Christopher Bolin and his Portland lecture. The Yanon plan, where they said in the 80s they wanted to break up. Israel Shahak translated that Hebrew magazine. Professor Israel Shahak, the great man, the same guy that wrote Jewish History, Jewish Religion, The Weight of 3,000 Years, the great man Israel Shahak, he translated that. And they said in the 80s, we're going to break up the Middle East into statelets that we will control, we'll get greater Israel. And the PNAC document took that up, the document, think tank document, securing the realm took that up. Netanyahu is ahead of that. He's written about it extensively. Like he said, America has the power but not the will to take on terrorism, or in other words, get rid of our enemies. And that's what you're seeing in Syria. Iran is, you know, Syria is still barely hanging on, really. It's not finished there yet. And Iran is waiting in the wings. And the Iranians are scared, trust me. They're building ballistic missiles and atom bombs. You've got to be careful. Woohoo! So I'm going to close this up now. It's a long run. I've got a lot of stuff to organise. Thank you for the donation, nearly $800. Please keep donating. The more money I have, the more power I have. I know people are hurting. It's $20, $10. My PayPal is working. The bank account's working. It took 4 days instead of two. Anyway, just a glitch. Bitcoin is working. So, you know, I'm pretty happy. But, you know, it's pretty stressful. I'm sitting here alone. I felt very isolated and alone. I've had to learn some hard lessons and some good, long, hard things. So please get behind me, smart, intelligent people. Could you please not come online and say, the Jews and all this. The game's chess, not checkers. Being on the run like I've been, going from country to country, I've got a bit of sympathy. I remember Mr. Zimmerman, a really nice guy, Jewish. He ran a photography company in Perth. And I asked him one day, I said, why do you people come from Lithuania? He said, mate, I said, why do you come from Lithuania all the way to Australia? He said, mate, to get as far away from the bullshit as possible. You think Mr. Zimmerman gives a crap? He goes to synagogue twice. He didn't give a crap. He pays his mortgage like everyone else, and I'll tell you. I wouldn't say ultra close, but pretty close to some of the Orthodox Jewish community. Many of them, some are converted to Christianity from well-known families. And they told me what was going on in those communities. The rates of sexual abuse, threats and intimidation is out of this world. They get stalked all around the world when they speak out. They get hammered and they get murdered. So I do have some sympathy for Jewish communities, but I'm asking you now, I do understand the culture in, I do understand the pressure you're under. I understand you get a lot of goodies. If you step out of line, they pull the goodies away. And if you still step out of line, you might find yourself, you know, waking up with a heart attack. They got it pretty hard in some respects, but it's time for you to speak out. There need to be 280,000 Jews marching in Times Square in New York, speaking out. If you don't, God help you. So I'm going to sign off, please. Pull your finger out. Let's get together and let's get writing to those MPs. Benjamin Netanyahu should not be in Australia. You know why he's there. I said on Club Conspiracy, a forum run years ago in 2005, things are getting curiouser and curiouser down under. They're moving in. They're moving in. It's an island continent. It's got massive resources. It's sitting underneath the biggest economic expansion in history. It's a pivot point. It's an aircraft carrier. This is a real pivot point to control the expansion of China and India, as that same parasitic element that took over the United States is now moving slowly but surely into China and India to control that expansion. And Australia is absolutely pivoting that. No one likes Netanyahu. No one likes Israel. If you give via public pressure our intelligence community, our military and our policing communities permission, they will tear Israel an arsehole. They will tear it. They don't like them. Nobody likes them. Phil Giraldi said it many times, former CIA station chief of Turkey. Nobody likes them. The FBI hates them. The CIA hates them. It's the politics and those core people they have. Just those core people like Dave Frasca, the head of the Muslim Fundamentalist Unit in the FBI, who single-handedly stopped five separate investigations into Muhammad Atta. Five. And I actually met the guy, Tufik Ali Sorora. He's going by the name of Tony Sammy. He was a protected witness held in Perth. $18 million he got from the US State Department, because he ratted on Muhammad Atta's crew. He brought him in via STT travel. He also did the first World Trade Center bombers, Tufik Ali Sorora. How do you like that? You wonder why I get fucking picked on and harassed? The stuff I found out, you wouldn't believe. And he's for real. Daniel Hopsicker knows about it. Someone on Daniel Hopsicker's site looked him up and said, he is for real. He was for real. I've got a signed statement by him, and here's the link. You can look it up. Go to my website, look it up. I'm going to sign off now. I'm going to head back to the hotel, edit this up. God bless you. Thank you for the money. Keep it coming in. Let's keep fighting. Please get your members of parliament. Let's not let Netanyahu walk around Australia. Let's make his name and his filth and his depravity and his racism and his hatred and his lunatic cult that he belongs to, Orthodox Judaism, Chabad Lubavitch, all of them, the Kahanas, there's dozens of these nutcase Jewish cults. We've got to expose them. Stop ragging on friggin' Islam night and day. Kurt Wilder's lived in Israel for years. All you patriot movements, you got no balls. You can't wait to bash Islam. I mean, if I bashed Islam, I'd have a $2 million contract by now. So if you want to be a big, brave Aussie, oi, 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 Anzac spirit, then come and join me. All right? I'm not here to protect Islam. Islam can protect itself, but they are getting shafted. This was part of the Yanon plan. They're running these crazy imams who start saying, death to America. Ha, ha, ha. We're going to rape all your women. All right? They're Israeli dupes. They're working for Israeli intelligence. They're Arabs who speak fluent Arabic, but they are Jewish, or they are compromised by Israeli intelligence, okay? And as Dr. Mahathir Mohamad, the former Prime Minister of Malaysia, says, Islam has to stop reacting. We all have to stop reacting, and we have to get smart and get together. And they want to divide Christian and put them against Islam, and we've got to stop it. That's why I love Sheikh Imam Hussein, based here in Malaysia, originally from Trinidad. You must watch his stuff. Thank you very much. Ciao for now.